Pune city and the areas around it is home to a multitude of wildlife. The landscape that surrounds us and these amazing creatures has greatly changed over the last decade. The growth in urban development, shifts in agricultural patterns, and climatic changes have led to an increasing number of wildlife coming into conflict. Increasingly, these animals have been getting reported to the helplines of our organization, Rescue Charitable Trust, that has been providing aid to animals in distress since 2007. In 2018, we dedicated a section of our land and resources for a wildlife unit, after which the Maharashtra Forest Department approved Rescue as a wildlife treatment transit center. Since then, we have been working with wildlife in many areas of rescue, rehabilitation, mitigating conflict, while strengthening our teams one step at a time. Rescue's intervention with wildlife generally revolves around five domains. 1. Wildlife comes to us requiring medical treatment or surgery and post-operative care. Impacted by either trauma-related wounds, injuries or infections, wildlife comes to us from several different situations. Mammals often come with fractures resulting from falls in wells, which require orthopedic surgeries and physiotherapy for post-op care. Sometimes, they also come from situations where their limbs have been stuck in poaching traps requiring surgical intervention to prevent complete amputations and to avoid lifelong captivity. Birds come in with fractured wings that require surgery or laser therapy to help them recuperate. These often are a result of them getting stuck in kite-flying manja, which is a perennial hazard, and many of them require surgical intervention to fix their bones, which get cut by the synthetic kind of manja. We also see injuries and wounds in birds like owls and eagles who have been subjected to superstitious rituals and later discarded by people who are conducting them. In the city especially, it is common to find black kites infected with avian pox, for which we have a separate isolation unit where these birds are treated. Primates often come to us in a critical state after electrocution, and their recovery almost entirely depends on how fast treatment is provided after the incident occurs. Snakes come to rescue after ingestion of foreign bodies like plastics or injuries resulting from farming or road accidents. Most show good recovery if surgical intervention is provided early. Many animals like deer, monkeys, and birds come to us with wounds and in shock after being attacked by other animals in and around the city. These wildlife are either soft or hard released into a safe habitat, based on the species, age of the animal, and after consideration of whether they came in from a known conflict area. The second type of cases that come to us are orphaned wildlife. When they get reported to rescue, the first line of action is always to attempt locating its mother and reuniting them. If reuniting fails, the orphans are brought to our center, hand-raised, rehabilitated, and based on the type of species, future release outcomes are determined. In the case of wildcat orphans, which get discovered in fields during harvesting time, we immediately conduct awareness with the locals at the site and request them to halt harvesting activities temporarily for 1 or 2 days. We attempt reuniting the orphans the same day and monitor the progress through live cameras. This has successfully been done for rusty spotted cats and jungle cats, who uncover the holding unit and retrieve their kittens when provided a safe opportunity to do so. In the case of leopard cubs who are juvenile, we track the mother and manually release the orphan once our live cameras are triggered by the presence of the mother. Orphan primates like rhesus and bonnet macaques come to us when their mothers have been killed in a road accident or by another animal. They are hand-raised initially, but once we are sure they can thrive independently, they are desensitized from human interaction at the right time to ensure that they don't permanently bond with their caretakers. Rehabilitation milestones are set to ensure the orphans learn the life skills that they will need in the future. Primates are social animals, and the orphans are introduced to other primates of a similar age as soon as they hit adolescence, so that they can socialize and bond with other monkeys and have a higher survival rate when released later as a group. Bird fledglings come to us when their nests are either abandoned or destroyed by strong winds. Sometimes, large numbers of nestlings and fledglings come in mass numbers at a time due to irresponsible tree felling incidents. These orphans are stabilized in our ICU units and hand-raised initially. Once they are older, they get transferred to a larger ex situ rehabilitation unit and introduced to other birds of the same kind if they are known to thrive in groups. Based on the species, they are soft released in socially formed groups or individually, like in the case of certain raptors. Other smaller mammals that come to us as orphans are squirrels, civets, and mongoose. These animals get hand-raised in enclosures that are enriched to simulate the environment that they will eventually get released into. The third kind are the wildlife that comes to us after being rescued from illegal captivity, either as pets or seized from illegal traders. Sometimes individuals are unaware that it is illegal to keep birds like parakeets as pets. People either surrender them when made aware, or they come to us if seized by the forest department. Provided they are physically fit, these birds, which are generally kept solitary in homes, are introduced to other parakeets of the same species until they form social groups and their affinity towards human interaction is diminished. They are released in groups in habitats where there is sufficient food and reduced human activity. As a result of the illegal pet trade, many scheduled species of turtles and tortoises get sold to customers looking for an easy, low-maintenance pet. For some of these species, whose distribution is limited or absent around Pune, we liaise with other departments and organizations to figure their transport for release in areas where their population is present. Monkeys, especially rhesus macaques, which are rescued from captivity, are integrated into groups with other monkeys who have either been rescued from the wild or from other captive conditions. Often, we coordinate with other NGOs and forest departments of nearby districts to transfer animals to them if they have an existing group, or get them sent to us so that the socialization process can be expedited. Pairing captive monkeys with the ones from the wild provides them an opportunity to have a higher survival rate when released out, since they have socially bonded and look out for each other. At rescue, we've had several rescued captive elephants in our care, which came from different situations. Some came after being rescued from begging, some from circuses, and the most recent elephant who came to us was rescued by the forest department after she was discovered in a miserable health condition and kept illegally by an individual without ownership papers. Elephants that come to us undergo rehabilitation involving medical care, proper nutrition and baths until they are fit to be transferred to elephant sanctuaries. Sometimes, wildlife ends up getting trapped in over and underground spaces, and rescuing them from such situations requires fast response, clear strategy, good equipment, and most importantly, a well-trained team. Our rescue team consists of professional climbers, veterinarians, and technically strong rescuers who are experienced in wildlife handling, behavior, and safety for animal and human both. When an animal like a leopard or deer has fallen down a well and gets reported to us, our first call is to the forest department as well as known local groups to reach the location and secure it. This helps to prevent stress to the animal by ensuring mob control before its rescue. Based on the animal type and site condition, a strategic plan is put in place before conducting the rescue to ensure that the right equipment is used and that the teams remain coordinated. Birds that get stuck on heights, sometimes on high-tension wires or in trees entangled by manja, are rescued by the use of tree climbing equipment or telescopic poles to ensure least damage to the animal during rescue. Snakes in the city often get stuck in nets or drain covers while trying to escape. Besides having experienced reptile handlers on our team who use safe snake capture techniques, we use different kinds of tools and hardware to make sure the rescue is safe for the catcher as well as the snake. A crocodile that we rescued from a toxic sewer canal presented us with more challenges than we were prepared for. No two technical rescues are the same because there are several factors that keep changing with each rescue. While revisiting strategy, improvisation, proper equipment, and a lot of patience results in an animal's final rescue, these animals are generally released as soon as possible after ensuring that they are in good health. Whether it is assisting the Forest Department in mitigating man-leopard conflict situations or educating individuals to not kill snakes when they accidentally enter urban settlements, members of our team conduct awareness in conflict areas to ensure human and wildlife safety. Besides working during a conflict situation, we engage in several preventive activities which involve educating school children as well as adults, making them aware about living with wildlife around them and peaceful coexistence. We also proactively engage in conducting training activities with different governmental departments and local groups to foster teamwork, faster response time, and stay updated about best practices in the field of wildlife treatment and rescue. In order to do the work we do, we have a dedicated 24-hour helpline where wildlife cases get reported to our team by the general public or by the Forest Department. We have animal ambulances with trained animal rescuers and field staff who respond to the wildlife emergencies. The rescue wildlife team consists of wildlife rescuers, rehabilitators, caretakers, and field staff. Our team members have different areas of expertise and experience. Some are great with reptiles and birds, some with mammals, and some technically strong in rescuing animals of all kinds. The Rescue Wildlife Center is nested on a hilltop just on the outskirts of Pune city. We have an ICU and nursery where infants or critical animals are stabilized under controlled conditions, as well as an operating theater where surgeries and small procedures are performed. Animal rehabilitation units are of varying sizes and are versatile so that they can be enriched and adapted based on the species that will be housed in it. Thanks to our gracious supporters, we have gradually managed to collect useful rescue equipment like telescopic poles, boats, and have self-engineered multi-use transport boxes, treatment cages, and several pieces of handy tools to ensure better handling of wildlife during treatment and transit. When rescued wildlife comes into the center, their details are entered into a web-based data management system called Fox Data Pro. All their medical records, rehabilitation progress, pictures and videos are logged into the system. The Pune Forest Department has online access to the system and can view the data from a computer or mobile phone with a few simple clicks. This system maintains all Forest Department registers electronically, along with summary reports of the work. In addition to providing complete information access and transparency to the Forest Department, the system is also used to generate release requests and transport permits to ease in the process and save resources for the department as well as the organization. We are able to do the work we do for wildlife because of the contributions from our supporters who have been following our work over the last decade. We regularly update our supporters of the work we do digitally through emails and awareness posts online. While our supporters and donors aid the work we do monetarily, it is the immense support we receive from the Forest Department that enables us to work together as a team. The work we do at Rescue Charitable Trust inherently involves rescuing wildlife from conflict of several different kinds, and many of them come to us in very critical conditions. While we put in our best efforts for each of them, we know that we cannot save every single animal. But one of the things that continues to drive us is their resilience to live when they are rescued or being treated. What motivates us is watching the ones that recover, getting released back in a safe habitat where they belong. Whether it is an animal running back into the wild or a bird flying into the sky, you know it's home, it is free, and it has had a second chance at life. Watching them free is what makes us go on.